All right, so good morning, everyone, and welcome to our third episode of this Mass Talks Mobility as a Service in three episodes. As I am sure most of you know, this is the third episode out of three. So we have had quite a journey up to here, and today we are going to discuss planning Mass and the mobility that we want. So previously we had really interesting talks about the Mass ecosystems, the business models that can be applied in Mass, and also obviously an introduction to Mass and its functionalities. For all these webinars, of course, I have to thank my co-host and actually moderator of these sessions, and Gabriele Greth, so thank you very much. And of course, I also need to thank the Icarus Project, which has made these webinars possible. So Icarus actually deals with three pillars, which are mobility as a service, behavioral change, and intermodality. So thanks to Icarus, in these three webinars, we wanted to deepen our knowledge with some experts on the topic. And so far, I think we have seen quite a lot of concepts, and we really understood that Mass is obviously not as easy as it may look, but it could give really good results, especially within specific areas and cities. So it could really prove the solution of the future in terms of mobility. As we are just a few people today, I'm really glad to kick this episode, and I leave the floor to Gabriele.
Okay, thank you, Leonora, for the introduction. As you said, today is the third episode, and we will deal with our final topic of planning Mass. We have had extensive in general introduction of the topic. We focused from the business perspective on business models and what are the main implications and reflections on the creation of an integrated mobility market. And today we, fit in the shoes of mobility planners to try to understand better together what are the main elements which has to be taken into account when planning the development and deployment of Mass initiatives in our territories. So, give you a quick overview of what we'll be talking in the next hour about. So first of all, as usual, we would like to know from you what are your the priorities on sustainable mobility that you think are central in your area. We will give you a bit of background on what are the main elements for planning Mass, and we will conclude the hour highlighting some findings and examples on strategic approaches that are on the way to be implemented in different areas, specifically in the city and the district of Ulm in Germany, and in the city and in city of Graz and district of Styria concerning Austria. So let me start immediately with our short brief poll. So I kindly ask you to go on menti.com and fill in the code which is here. The question is, what is the main priority for sustainable mobility in your area? Which is a question which can be answered by policymakers, but also by citizens and mobility operators as well, indeed. Let's see. Okay, considering the number of participants, I would say the majority has expressed its vote. And so the reduction of congestion and car dependency seems to be a priority for the areas we are representing here. This, of course, shows somehow that we are, let's say, interpreting the main challenges of urban and metropolitan areas, more or less, considering that, of course, the main priority is quite a rough distinction, since the key objective, usually, of sustainable mobility have a broader range. Anyway, this results makes me think that, anyway, defining key objectives and a long-term vision for mobility represent the fundamental part starting point of any planning process, and especially when we are talking about planning for mass trying to identify what are the main elements we have to take into consideration. We will see today how the planning process can be developed and what elements we should take into account in order to guarantee a correspondence between the objectives or priorities and the impact of mass on citizens' lives and territorial sustainable development that we want to achieve. So first of all, let's have a look at some of the sustainable urban mobility planning principles, which are stated in the SUMP 2.0 guidelines, which you can find on the ELTIS website at European level and represent, let's say, the blueprint for sustainable urban mobility nowadays. Let's highlight for each of these challenges we selected, principles we selected, the main challenges which can be especially relevant for mobility as a service. A first challenge related to the principle of planning the sustainable mobility network in a functional city, in a functional area, is for sure related to accessibility and convenience, and how to plan accessible and convenient services along multimodal chains in terms of infrastructure, in terms of services, as well as in terms of travel information, especially when we are considering a functional area where different levels of mobility are encompassed. Moreover, again, considering functional areas, how to connect and serve outskirts where public transport operations are either nor viable or nor, let's say, commercially feasible. So how to plan, to connect, to integrate services in order to find innovative answers. Let's not forget as well, since we are talking about a composite environment, the need to ensure a balanced and sustainable transport supply, especially when the services are somehow complementary or even competing with each other. One of the main aspects is planning is always related to inclusiveness. And when we are talking about digitalization in transport systems, we are talking about digital access and digital capabilities of the final users. Last but not least, it's always fundamental in the planning process, especially in broader areas, to understand and identify the different needs of different target groups and find solutions not only for those citizens which have easier access to services, but especially to the ones which are potentially underserved by the mobility network. Another key element of mobility planning is the development, as we said before, of a long-term vision. And this is particularly crucial for MaaS because it fosters a radical evolution of the mobility ecosystem. So we have to think how to integrate local and regional MaaS visions. We have to think how to define the role of different public authorities within this ecosystem as regulators, as enablers, as coordinators of the ecosystem. And related to that, how to align and deal with different times perspective in planning that the different administrations have. Moreover, we have to clearly create commitment among public actors, but also among key stakeholders in order to overcome the main barriers to integration. And last but not least, we have to identify what are the common key measures we want to pursue in order to enable the establishing and the growth of a MaaS ecosystem. Namely, we have to define a governance system for the take-up of the mobility concept, of the mobility as a service. When it comes then to the assessment and monitoring level of the actions and the measures, it's fundamental to make the best possible use of information in order to ensure that the evolution of the mobility as a service ecosystem is then fulfilling the original needs and objectives. So those key elements and the long-term vision. This is not an easy process. When you define the system of assessment of the performance of the system to be implemented, we have to consider aspects like the access of data, the organization of data, and the availability, the definition of customer relationship systems or similar aspects, similar tools, which better gather the information and get a better understanding of the needs of the users, maybe using digital tools, using functionalities which are enabled by the mobility as a system platform or mobility system. Mobility as a service platforms. And then you have also to consider the potential demand. So those people who currently don't use multimodal mobility, don't use digital platforms, but that represent our potential demand. And as well, we have to define a baseline in the very beginning of our implementation process in order to define and to monitor the progress of the actions we are implementing. Then we come somehow to the core of MaaS, which is the development of a coordinated network of services. Which have to reach different degrees of integration on different levels of integration. So physical, logical, digital, tariff integration, and so on. And the question is how to enable this. We have few more key challenges here related to the quality of data and how we want to gather it, and especially how we want to foster the interoperability of the systems in order to enable the exchange of data. On a broader perspective, how to create a level playing field for the market actors, both from the transport production point of view and from the delivery of services. So both a fair competition environment for the services themselves, as well as for the potential integrators. And last but not least, we have to identify a strategy to govern and integrate the new services into the ecosystem in a more dynamic way, especially for high density areas where services come and go, innovation can come in different specific segments. And of course, in order to catch the benefits, we have to be ready, and we need an ecosystem, a mobility as a service ecosystem, ready to integrate. At the same time, when we are talking about low demand areas, the question is slightly different, but not so different, is how to attract and allow new services to adapt to the context, even if maybe the market process is a bit less dynamic. Some further challenges emerge when we deal with cooperation across boundaries, both at local level, so with different governance levels, as well as international, so for cross-border operations, for example. Challenges are related to how to support and incentivize the willingness of all mobility providers, both public and private, to cooperate in mass ecosystem, first of all, because if the cooperation, let's say, environment is not ready, we are basically building empty boxes and not generating benefits. A level of coordination includes both the coordination between urban and interurban services, as well as we said, the integration between national and cross-border services for specific regions and areas. And since we are in the Interreg environment, this aspect is maybe also interesting to take into account. Moreover, we have to consider, let's say, what is the role of public administrations in coordinating and creating the conditions for interoperability at all levels, and what should be the common ground rules for the use of advanced data sharing practices and as well systems. In order to, let's say, also support better informed traffic management, urban planning, and in general, the vision of an intelligent, of a smart city. So data, the data shared inside the different levels of competition are not only useful for the end user, but as we said also in previous episodes, are fundamental in order to better planning and more dynamically planning mobility and, in general, local sustainable development policies. In general, the system, a mass system or ecosystem, is not only supposed to improve the use or the availability or the accessibility to public transport or to shared modes for those citizens which already use these services. But a special attention should be put on how to reach the so-called non-users, those users which by, let's say, attitude or habit are non-multimodal, non-sharing or public transport oriented, in order to deliver the added value of the integration, the benefits, and to exploit the potential of the system on a broader scale. At the same time, as we said before, challenges are somehow recurring. So we must ensure the inclusiveness when we look at how we should involve citizens and stakeholders. So we must include them in the process in terms of principle in the planning process, as well as we must be able to build on common understandings and common design of services which must be included, inclusive. At the same time, one key success factor of the engagement of citizens is the way we must foster a dialogue among stakeholders, and as well foster the success of public-private people partnerships through, for example, co-design approaches to services, systems of monitoring which include common feedback systems, etc. And since we are not talking only about building an architecture, but of populating an ecosystem, it's fundamental through the engagement process to identify right committed partners which can put resources in common and give consistency to the design of a mass framework. So, okay, this is in general what we want to achieve and what are mainly the barriers or the challenges which we have to keep in mind when we want to start our process. But when we start, it's important to ask ourselves, are we ready for mass? Is my territorial entity, either it's a functional urban area, either is a low demand area, is a region, is a city, and so on, is it ready for, so do we have these preconditions in order to implement mass, and what kind of mass will come out from the engagement process or from the building and planning and building process according to the endowment conditions, let's say. I give you now a short tour on possible approaches and tools to evaluate your territory towards mass in order to identify conditions and gaps, strengths and weaknesses, and the impacts to be expected when you start your process. The first one that you see in this slide is the mass readiness indicator, which was generated within the Civitas Excentric project, and whose aim is to describe the context where mass could be established. The self-assessment proposed here resulting in this diagram, which is supposed to provide local authorities with a view on what are the areas where the readiness level is more satisfactory, and so where it's not necessary to act in terms of policies, and what are the areas where there is still work to be done in order to set up the scene for mass to happen. The critical elements which are considered here are specifically the strategic focus, the parking policy, so the management of the city spaces and infrastructure, the guidelines for traveling, especially for civil servants and public servants, the existence of shared mobility, as well as their, let's say, market penetration, both in terms of shared use as well as multimodal behaviors. The strategy related to public transport, so how public transport is acting towards integration and towards multimodality. the existence of an integration platform at different levels or specific preconditions such as integrated ticketing, integrated booking, etc., etc. And as well, what visibility the shared option have for the final users. These, of course, represent all preconditions which don't really, let's say, shape directly the different model of mobility as a service that you can build, but give you, let's say, a benchmark on what are the preliminary actions that have to be, let's say, taken into account before starting the planning process. In this slide, you also find the link to the tool in case you want to test your territory against these specific criteria to evaluate your readiness level. Another way to look at this aspect from a different perspective is the mass maturity index that you see summarized in this slide. This is based on five core dimensions that you can see through which a city's potential to introduce mass is assessed. So how mature basically is your environment for the implementation of mass. These five dimensions, as you can see, go from transport operators' openness and data sharing, policy regulation, citizen familiarity and willingness, transport services and infrastructure, and the presence as well of ICT infrastructure. These five dimensions then in the index, which is rather complex, are then defined further in a range of sub-dimensions. And of course, in this case, the application is more, is let's say, less ready-made and more for planners or even for academics rather than for let's say citizens that want to have a general assessment of how their territory stands. But these two tools don't really, in my opinion, exhaust or complete the need for assessment, for preliminary assessment that the planning process really needs. And why? Because, in my opinion, we are now in need of a bit more guidance on what are the consequences once we have assessed our readiness of, let's say, setting up different frameworks in terms of openness towards the market. And this is not a, let's say, a value judgment, but it's clear that different approaches, different operational models and business models will result in different, let's say, market pictures or market equilibria. In the future when the approach is complete. That's why there is currently under development this new approach which is called Mass Scenario Self-Assessment Tool, which will be finalized at the beginning of 2022. So you have to be a bit patient for it, which is basically based on the preliminary analysis of four main themes to assess the characteristics of the territory, basically territorial characteristics, socioeconomic, operational aspects of the mobility market. And this gives a first idea, is intended to be a first to give a first idea of what is the socioeconomical context for the implementation of mass. Then the system is also, this tool will be based on the identification and analysis for the specific context of seven specific challenges, which are, let's say, defining the market, the mobility market framework, which include an analysis of the access to the market and the barriers to integration, the existence or potential of public-private partnerships, the scalability of the different models, possible restrictions to the integration, especially of digital and payment tools, all the, let's say, background policies related to that, to data, and so on. The objective of this tool is to critically assess these seven challenges within the context described by the socio-economic analysis, and to then have as a result a range of scenarios which answer to the question, what if I basically apply different operational and business models to my local environment? The idea is to provide, let's say, a support to the decisions in order to try to understand not only how aligned is my, let's say, mobility as a service framework, which I want to build with the primary objectives of my sustainable mobility system, but also to identify what are the impacts also in terms of market, of impact on the final user in terms of accessibility, in terms of costs, etc., related to the application of one of the three different models that we have seen in the previous lesson. The idea, of course, is not only to provide a general framework for let's say densely populated area, but also to focus on the main objective of this process, the provision of guidance, identifying a mass vision for different areas with different characteristics. So, as you can see, the context where mass is being developed is rather complex, and a range of emerging tools can help correct and conscious and streamlined planning process. But of course, the planning process for mobility as a service, as integrator of mobility, of local mobility and transport services, is rather complex, but has to be integrated in a broader perspective, which is the sustainable mobility planning process process in general, which includes infrastructures, new services, etc. Therefore, now let's have a look at the planning process, which is defined in general by the SAMP policy cycle, so the sustainable urban mobility planning process, and to see what are the main elements in this policy cycle that we have to take into account in order to efficiently and effectively plan mobility as a service for our territory. So the first step of the cycle is called preparation and analysis. And looking at from the mass perspective, what is important and fundamental? First of all, as we said before, bringing stakeholders and citizens together. Because mass systems are, let's say, beneficial when they are co-designed, because they work when there is trust and when there is collaboration between different actors, because they are a way to find new ways of integration between, for example, private and public stakeholders, private and public actors which are engaged in the same playing field. And in order to do that, it's also important to, let's say, create a level of trust, but also set up rules which are defining in a fair way this playing field for future cooperation, but also competition, indeed. Last but not least, in the preparation phase, it's very important to identify clearly what are the main characteristics of the context in terms of preconditions for the development of MaaS. So what elements are already in place, and we have seen three possible methods of assessing this, and also for the identification of what are the needs and expectations of the demand, but also of the key stakeholders from the supply side, in terms of what kind of model they want to shape together and what benefits they expect together from this experience. The second macro component of the cycle is the strategy development. In this sense, the main element, the starting point, is of course the identification of the key objectives on which we want to build our future MaaS. Many examples are possible. From our doodle poll, we identified the three main key objectives, but they can be defined in a more precise way. So the increase of model share for environmentally friendly mobility options, the reduction of private car use or ownership, the improving in mobility accessibility, equity, the capacity of influencing travel behavior, for example, the engagement of users on a, let's say, socially responsible level, or the improvement, why not, of air quality and health for citizens, even if it was a bit, let's say, the less preferred option in our initial poll. MaaS is clearly a tool to pursue these key objectives, so it has to be designed around a strong core of key objectives, and it can be used also in order to manage the mobility demand and to support the attractiveness of different transport modes. These are part, of course, of the MaaS strategy. it's important, you know, also when, let's say, defining and developing a common strategy, to start discussing some, let's say, key and sometimes challenging and unpleasant aspects, such as, for example, the sharing of risks and profits within the ecosystem. For example, the sharing of data and the duties and benefits of related and connected to it, as well as the definition of governance models for the ecosystem, responsibilities, and possibly subsidy and incentive frameworks when these are applicable and necessary. So rather discuss this before in the setup of the strategy than, let's say, postponing this discussion among stakeholders and then not finding an agreement on how the ecosystem should be functioning indeed. Not less important is to define how we want to use the data and how we expect our, let's say, algorithms for integration are supposed to be developed. This, of course, is connected to the operational model we are going to adopt, but is typical of public functions, identify and to make sure that the algorithms for the definition, for example, of itineraries and preferences are fitting, of course, on the single user, but are also somehow compatible with the key objectives and with the long-term vision on sustainable mobility. And in order to guarantee this and to, let's say, continuously adjust the characteristics of our mobility as a service framework to the public, to the common objective, is necessary to create a consistent evaluation framework, which has to be clearly in line with the key objectives we designed and we agreed upon in the first place. The third area of development, or the first step, big step of sustainable mobility planning, is the planning of the measures. So, what should be the point of view and the role of public administrations or steering groups for mobility as a services or groups of qualified stakeholders? Well, first of all, the role, the stakeholders, the key stakeholders, are somehow the engine of the implementation of MaaS concepts, has to recognize these, let's say, central position. Therefore, in general, when we look at the definition of measures from the planning perspective, I would say planners have mainly the role to, or specifically the role of fostering innovation, for example, making funds available for trials and pilots, since this is also important in order to stimulate and foster co-design approaches and the identification of innovative solutions, etc. And at the same time, it's very important that policymakers and mobility planners are aware of the need of creating, basic preconditions for the MaaS environment to function and to function accordingly to key objectives. Therefore, for example, modernizing planning, booking, and ticketing systems is an option. So, investing in technology as enabler for the MaaS ecosystems. We will see later the cases of Ulm and Graz where these aspects have been taken into account in the very first phases. At the same time, it's important that the public policies are oriented to support the interoperability of services also on the physical level by developing infrastructure, for example, the so-called multimodal hubs in certain areas, and we have several experiences in Austria, for example, also at national level, of a very coordinated approach. And therefore, it's important also that we don't only look at the governance and how the system should look from the market perspective, but also at what, what preconditions must be provided in order to create an ecosystem which is then, after all, attractive for service providers. So local administration, in the end, are not necessarily requested to build a MaaS, but rather to foster collaboration among key stakeholders and to create those preconditions by being proactive and active on different levels: regulatory, infrastructure development, integrating and fostering participation and engagement and so on. And this seems to be a secondary role, but it's actually not, because without these preconditions and without the creation of suitable environment for cooperation, no MaaS implementation can really succeed in fulfilling common objectives and creating added value for the final users as conscious citizen of a sustainable environment. Last but not least, the step of implementation and monitoring of the measures. So what we have to do in order to make it effective? For sure, a high degree of coordination of the initiatives is is fundamental in order to, let's say, respect the correspondence between implementation and the architecture which is being built. Another function which is crucial is the monitoring of the process and the capacity of adaptation of the policies as well as of the strategies to new conditions and new context. And in order to do so, a public administration must be very active in continuously engaging both citizens and stakeholders in the progress and in the implementation of the measures. And even if, as we said, public administrations might not be the ones which, let's say, build the MaaS platform or build the MaaS platform, build and define the MaaS ecosystem in all its aspects, it's very important that a dedicated structure for the governance of the mobility system through MaaS is set up, taking into account the role of the different local stakeholders, public stakeholders and public authorities. We will see shortly the case of Ulm, which is a quite interesting case. So, as we said, and last but not least, I'm sorry, I was forgetting, but since we are talking about regulated systems or services or licensed services, the implementation and the elaboration of innovative procurement practices from the public point of view are very, very important in order to create the stimulus and the, let's say, incentives to the integration of different services into the MaaS platform and to the, of course, sharing of data and information for towards a more integrated mobility. So I'll give you, just to conclude, two examples of processes in place, but that I think are very, very interesting for the purpose of starting the journey of implementing MaaS in your region, in your area. The first example is the example of the city of Ulm, which is basically building its strategy on data, and namely on open data. The city builds an open data platform, which is potentially then creating the condition for the adoption of a model, an operational model, which could be the open backend platform operational model described in episode 2. In parallel, the city is developing specific open source codes for some functionalities, for example, multimodal trip planning, and for specific services such as an open bike, let's say, peer-to-peer system for bike sharing. And on the, let's say, marketing point of view, is promoting a better integration of new services within the platform. At the moment, we cannot define this example openly as a mobility as a service implementation, since mobility as a service players are not yet there or not yet ready to connect to the open data platform and provide new services. But what we have to say and what is clear is that entry barriers will be in the future very, very low thanks to this basic implementation. And fairness and reciprocity principles are respected for data sharing, since the approach envisages also new policies and specific policies for data sharing. Moreover, engagement and collaborative approaches are adopted here with a threefold purposes: to attract services, as we said, to the ecosystem, to scale up the services at district level, so from the city to the district, as well as to scale up the solutions which are implemented and they are open source to other contexts, both national and international, and mutually learn from each other. This is very, very interesting because the services, the platform is continuously improved by inputs which come from similar experiences or from other territorial contexts which adopt the open data and open source approach in their territories. And this is, has a very, very high scaling up potential. So in general, the city plays a crucial role in this case in fostering and implementing regulatory approaches and practices towards open data and define basically the engagement besides the IT architecture, especially the engagement rules for the ecosystem. Therefore, this is an approach which maybe is, let's say, less tangible in terms of development of a front-end platform or a front-end integrated application, but is defining and setting the scene for potentially a market which is going to be very, very, let's say, efficient and fair and collaborative. The second example, as I'm running out of time, is the example of the city of Graz, which is rather building on defining a governance model for mobility as a service. In this case, the approach, the strategic approach is to develop a mass platform at regional level, which is publicly run. What did they do in Graz? They built on two relevant preconditions. The first one is an electronic ticketing application, which is called Graz Mobile, which represents the starting point for the implementation of the mobility as a service concept. The second one is more physical, is related to physical infrastructure. They are creating multimodal mobility stations where different modes of transport, let's say, interact and are connected. They focus, as we said, on the governance, multi-level governance, by identifying and implementing a steering group with six members from the city, from the municipal holding, from the regional management, from the province government and from the transport association, in order to be representative of different governance levels. And they are, governing the process of building mass through this steering group. This guarantees a very good alignment between key objectives and actions and characteristics of the mobility as a service platform and environment. Indeed, as an example, they are in Graz is being discussed currently the potential of implementing mobility packages for users, so integrating different different mobility options according to different kind of user groups, and this is clearly very, very aligned in line with the objective of creating convenient and affordable access to sustainable mobility in order to be effectively alternative to private motorized mobility, creating congestion in the city. So as you see from these very, very short examples and from what we have said before, there is no predefined approach to design and implement MaaS. But we have a variety of guidance tools and specific points of attention to be taken into consideration. We have to, shape our MaaS according to the mobility we want, so the services we want in and the key objectives we want to follow. We have to, be guided and follow the planning steps in order to identify models and approaches which are able to maximize the expected benefits of creating a MaaS ecosystem in our city, in our metropolitan area, and in our region. So this was my last hint or suggestion. Now we are open for questions for a few minutes in case someone has some specific curiosity, for example, on the cases I presented. So I leave the floor to Eleonora.
Yeah, so thank you very much, Gabriele, for your presentation. And I think we have run out a little bit out of time. I also think there are no questions from what I see and also from the chat. So I think we can just close the webinar here. And I would just like to take the opportunity again to thank everyone for taking part. The webinars will actually be available on YouTube, so you'll be able to watch it later. And also, you can always, thank you, Gabriele, write to us or follow on our social networks and look at our news on our website. So we truly hope you enjoyed this journey and this short series, and we hope we'll be able to organize some other events soon. I would also like to tell you that if you are interested to keep in touch with us, we actually do have some other events, so you can just get in touch and we'll share our events with you. Again, thank you and have a nice afternoon.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you very much. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.